So the other major category of abiotic factors that we look at in ecosystem ecology comes from chemistry. Now what we want to look at is what's called nutrient cycling. We want to watch the flow of vital chemicals between the physical environment and living organisms. Remember, there are five elements that are essential to life because this is essential for the production of DNA. When we have our nucleotide base, so the GATCA of Gattaca going along, they're connected to sugars, deoxyribose, and phosphate chain. We've never really talked about the phosphate chain or the sugar. We didn't want to. We wanted to look at the sequences that led to certain proteins being transcribed. But now we're going to look at the physical elements that make up all the different parts of the DNA. And they are hydrogen, oxygen, carbon, which is not usually drawn by organic chemists because they assume you're going to know that's a C and a C and a C. But it is. It's carbon. And then phosphorus, which is in the phosphate chain. So without these five, you can't make DNA. In the air we breathe, nitrogen is the most common element of all. 70% of the air is nitrogen, but it's in the form of N2, and that's biologically inert. In order to be able to absorb nitrogen for biological utility, it has to be converted to a compound. And there are only a few organisms on Earth that are capable of making that transformation. And they're bacteria. Legumes have nodules in their roots that can fix atmospheric nitrogen and convert it into another form. And legumes, familiar forms of legumes, are alfalfa, clover, and peanuts. Now, in the nodules in their roots are what are called rhizobia. And the rhizobia are bacteria that actually do the work of taking nitrogen in the form of N2 and converting it into ammonium. So between the bacteria, the rhizobium in the plant's root system, there's also free-living soil bacteria that can do the same thing. So we have this nitrogen-fixing bacteria that convert into ammonium, and then there are other bacteria that convert ammonium, which is down here, into nitrites. And then further, more bacteria that convert into nitrates. And it's the nitrates that then can be absorbed by the plants that they can then use for the manufacture of proteins, DNA, and all the essential elements of living things. Now, when plants die, there are more organisms, decomposers, that can then take the nitrogen and put it back into different forms in the soil. And so the dead plants and even dead animals leave their nitrogen behind, and that's absorbed by various organisms that live in the soil. Now, the key point about all this is that this is a limiting process. Nitrogen is the most abundant element in the gas of the air, and yet it's very hard to get enough nitrates in order to allow things to live and grow. So, nitrogen often limits plant growth. If we think about the carrying capacity of different systems, we're often talking about the fact that there's only so much nitrogen to support the plants. Now, in a natural system, nitrogen is being deposited by the rhizobia in the legumes, but it's very slow. And so the net deposition of nitrogen from the atmosphere is on the order of just a couple of kilograms a year per hectare, and a hectare is about 100 square meters, so it's pretty low. And this is a map across the U.S., and in places in the Midwest, the deposition is higher than others, but it's never that much, okay? And so if we look at what's happened because of agricultural practices, we add a lot of fertilizer, which is rich in nitrates and ammonium. And if we look at the amount of fertilizer being deposited, this is on the order of dozens of kilos, hundreds of pounds of fertilizer per hectare every year. And so as a percentage of contribution to the nitrogen in the soil, it's mostly coming from fertilizer. Natural systems themselves are only adding a small amount. So we've been able to increase the productivity of our crops enormously by fertilizing them. Nitrogen is an important, almost an essential fertilizer. It's something that really increases the plant production because otherwise Every plant in the system has to wait for those legumes and the rhizobia to slowly convert nitrogen into ammonia. But if we add it ourselves, take that shortcut, we can rapidly increase productivity. But the problem with adding fertilizer is that our crops can only absorb a small fraction of what we put on the ground. The rest is washed off when it rains, and it flows into streams and lakes, and this feeds algae. And the algae, which had been limited in these ponds, likewise, by an absence of nitrogen, they can now grow like crazy. But they grow so rapidly that you get what's called eutrophication. And with that excess algal growth in these streams and in rivers, and even in small seas, that removes all the oxygen from the water. And that creates a dead zone. And we're seeing this on a really broad scale now. Here are two different examples of excess nitrogen. Here's a lake in Guatemala where you can see this massive growth of algae that's visible from space. And here the Caspian Sea, which is in Eurasia. You have fertilizer that's being washed off the surrounding croplands into the water, algal blooms. And it's a phenomenal change that's happening because of the fertilizer that we've been applying with such vigor over the last 100 years or so. And the consequence is that now we're adding biologically active nitrogen into the environment at a rate that has not occurred in the last 2.5 billion years. A limiting resource for billions of years, biologically active nitrogen is now being added to the environment far faster than can be safely absorbed.